This is the Schmo with the Pro, former LFA middleweight champion and former college football national champion, Eryk. How we doing?
Man, we're doing all right, man. Appreciate you having me on the show.
Of course, my friend. Now let's go back to your college football playing days. You played with some beasts at that linebacker position. Rolando McClain, Donta Hightower, under Coach Nick Saban, Kirby Smart defensive coordinator. How was that for you?
Man, it was an experience. You know, before Coach Saban got there, it was pretty much, you know, just go get the ball kind of thing. You know, super simple defenses. When Saban got there, man, that playbook is literally a 3-inch binder, and every play is 3 plays. If this guy motions here, we're going to do this, that, and the third. So, you know, it was very complex and difficult to learn.
Now, you played all 4 years, finally getting that national title at the end, and then you had a brief stint with the Browns. What was the decision for you from being an NFL pro to an MMA fighter?
Well, if it was up to me, I'd still be playing football, you know. But football decided it was done with me. So once all that ended, you know, I did the 9-to-5 thing, working a job, and just, you know, found myself frustrated and upset all the time. So I walk into a gym looking to just blow off some steam, work out a little bit. I wrestled a little bit in high school, so I figured jiu-jitsu would be pretty similar to that. The first day in the gym, the coach, you know, was like, you know, can you fight? You know, I'm 5 out of 6 kids and grew up fighting in the streets and whatnot. So I was like, yeah, I could fight. He's like, all right, cool. Go spar that guy. And, you know, he turned out to be UFC heavyweight Walt Harris. So, you know, at the time, I thought I could fight until I fought somebody who could fight. And then I realized I didn't know anything. So, you know, I fell in love with it right then and there. I knew that I had to develop a whole new skill set, learn, grow, and develop. And, you know, pretty much been doing it ever since.
Got that Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu brown belt. You're still learning. You're still growing up on the streets of Alabama. Real quickly, Nick Saban, your former coach, he's been in the news. He lately said he doesn't like these underclassmen declaring for the NFL draft early. You stayed there for a long period of time. What's your thoughts on that? You got to get your chance to get paid, or do you see his point about staying there for a bigger payday at the end?
Man, you know, I see both sides of it, you know. A lot of those kids, they come from nothing, you know. So, you know, they'll have what he's saying is go if you have a first or second round, if you're predicted to go in the first or second round. Because at worst, if you're predicted to go in the first, at worst, you're probably going to go in the third and still make some money. But if you're projected to go in the third, man, you might not get drafted at all. You might slide all the way down to the 6th round or 7th round, and there goes all your money, you know. The thing is, you know, the thing that he's trying to tell these kids is, you know, everybody's got an uncle. You know, everybody's got an uncle who's, you know, who's looking out for the kid or whatever. But at the end of the day, it all comes down to money. You know, you've been struggling for 20, 21 years. What's another year? And then you get even more money long term. And also, if you're that first or second round draft pick, now the team has money invested in you. So they're going to give you more chances. You're not going to get cut. They're not going to get traded like that. But if you're a 5th or 6th round or 7th round free agent, and, you know, they don't have anything invested in you. So, you know, it's not hard for them to get rid of you, so to speak.
Always a risk for injury, though. And Eddie Jackson, Chicago Bears safety, Alabama, first round talent. He had that leg injury. What happens if you get the injury and you can't play again, though? That's the other side of the argument.
Yeah, you know, I've also seen it work the other way. You know, a guy has a second round. You know, there was a guy when I was playing there, he was the number 2 safety. Projected to come out, he stayed and then didn't get drafted at all. So, you know, man, you know, there's always risk for injury, but, you know, especially if you know, you haven't gotten hurt up until this point, stug it out another year, get your money up, improve your stock, and, you know, you'll have more money long term.
Now let's talk about the fighting. You started at middleweight, now you're fighting at light heavyweight. Are you doing both divisions, or are you now a full-time light heavyweight?
Man, you know, I get in where I fit in. You know, this is just the first fight that came across this year. So, you know, it's a fight that intrigued me. You know, he moves forward. He's not going to run around in circles and try and, you know, kick me with his big toe. You know, he's going to, you know, be in my face. We're going to slug it out. And, you know, I think this fight ends with somebody on their back.
Definitely. Speaking of someone on their back, he had an impressive run. But Jonny Walker with that elbow, he stopped him early in his last fight. What were your thoughts of Jonny Walker in that fight and where he stands in that light heavyweight division?
I think Jonny Walker is going to be tough to beat, man. You know, he comes in there. You know, I know he looks like he's always goofing around, but, you know, he's calm, cool, collected, and, you know, he gets in there, and, you know, you see what he's done to all his opponents up until this point in the UFC. You know, I think he's got three fights with a total of 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes of fight time in three fights. You know, that's pretty impressive. So, you know, I really don't look at that Jonny Walker fight to gauge where Khalil Rountree's at, because Jonny Walker is 6'6", I'm 6'1". You know, he's got different attributes and a totally different skill set than I have. So, you know, I think it'd be foolish for me to look at that fight and be like, oh, you know, I think that, you know, I can do the same thing. You know, I do plan on touching him, you know, hitting him and knocking him out. But, you know, probably not like Jonny Walker did.
And prepared to go the distance if need be.
Oh, absolutely. You know, I think the longer this fight goes, the more it goes in my favor, because, you know, he's shown to leave it all out there in that first round. And, you know, he'll be strong for the first minute, 2 minutes of each round, but he'll start to fade and get a little sloppy with his punches and whatnot. So there'll be a hell of a storm to weather, but I'm sure I'll come out on the other side of it.
And at the top of the division, an opponent that you lost to, Thiago Santos, he's fighting John Jones July 6th. What do you think of that matchup?
Man, I think Thiago's a wild card. You know, he throws a lot of crazy kicks from crazy angles and whatnot. So, you know, but, you know, I think that John Jones is the best. You know, his best skill set is Thiago's weakest skill set, and that's the wrestling. And I think that's where the fight is going to come down to. I don't see John Jones taking too many chances with a hard hitter and a wild card like that. I think he's going to take him down, submit him.
Obviously, you have championship aspirations. It's in your blood. How do you see a John Jones or anyone at the top fight shaping out for you and your legacy ongoing with your career?
Man, I like my chances with anybody. You know, I think I got one punch knockout power. So, I think it'd be, you know, foolish, especially at this point, for me to say that I go out there and knock out John Jones. But when I do get there, I'll be ready for the opportunity.
And you're training in altitude now over in Colorado.
Yeah, you know, it's helping, big deal. You know, when I first got there, I could really feel it in my lungs, gassing out, getting tired. But, you know, I trained there for about 6 weeks, so, you know, I feel confident with my cardio. And, man, I think the biggest thing is how fast I recover now, you know. And that's a big thing, that when you see guys, you know, get hit, when they're not in shape, they don't recover and it does more damage. So I feel like I'm in really good shape, probably the best shape I've been in before a fight. So even if Khalil does touch me, I think I'll be able to recover and, you know, weather that storm.
Now, Eryk, is your nickname Your Boy or Your Boy?
It's Your Boy.
Your Boy.
Yeah, that's it.
How'd you get that?
Man, it's just kind of what I taught, man. You know, the guys in the gym started making fun of me. I'd be like, you know, come help your boy out, or do this for your boy, or do that for your boy. And everybody just started saying, your boy, your boy, your boy. And then it just kind of stuck.
It stuck with you that way.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, what do you think about the main event? Do you like Dustin Poirier winning that fight, or do you like Max Holloway?
Man, I'm going with the diamond. You know, I think that he's got a chip on his shoulder. He's been fighting a long time, long time. This is his first title shot. I don't see him letting it get away from him. Obviously, that we're playing with 4 ounce gloves, so anything could happen. But, you know, I think that Poirier's inside boxing is going to be the difference in this fight.
How about Calvin Gastelum against Israel Adesanya?
I think that Israel's a tough matchup for anybody in the middleweight division. You know, I was actually talking with him and stood next to him. And, man, he's super tall, you know, long limbs. And I think that he utilizes range and distance better than anybody in the division. I think that Calvin's best shot is to take him down. But, you know, I think he's got one. You know, I think his takedown defense, you know, I think he's had like 13 or 14 shots shot on him. Only one person's taking him down. So, I don't see it playing out well for Calvin.
And recently, we just heard the news. TJ Dillashaw suspended 2 years, EPO. What do you make of that situation?
Man, you know, I he hasn't really said anything about it that I've seen. But, he accepted his punishment. You know, it kind of seems like, yeah, I knew what I was doing kind of thing. You know, it's hard to argue that it's a tainted supplement, you know, because EPO doesn't exist in, you know, pre-workout supplements. So, you know, I think it's obvious that he did it. Seems like he's accepting responsibility for it. And, hopefully in 2 years we'll see him back.
And that Cody Garbrandt tweet.
Yeah, you know, he let him know. You know, I don't really necessarily agree with what he said at that press conference about how TJ showed everybody at Alpha Male how to, you know, do steroids because he just kind of snitched on all his teammates.
Snitching on his teammates.
Yeah, it's frowned upon. It's a no-no. But, you know, he wasn't lying, as it turns out.
And Eryk, my friend, what's your one message for all the fans out here for UFC 236 and the ATL for Saturday evening?
Hey, you guys make sure to tune in, man. I think it's going to be a hell of a card. I think that everybody's sleeping on me and Khalil's fight. I think it's going to be a great fight for the fans and, you know, should be fireworks.
Action-packed fight card, main event fight card. This guy, Eryk Anders, your boy.
I appreciate you guys. Tune in.
He's the pro. I'm the Schmo. We're out.